Right then, so welcome to our theme park worldwide USA road trip summary.
Conclusion, this is it.
This is it. We are back here at the world of theme parks. And I tell you what, it feels weird to be sat back here after doing such a absolutely amazing trip that you guys have only just finished following here on the channel. However, for us, it actually ended about five weeks ago. So that's why we're feeling nice and relaxed and ready to chat to you guys. Now, the reason that we didn't film this as soon as we came back from the trip was because I wanted to see what all of you guys were commenting on the videos, so when we sat down here, we could answer the majority of those questions and give you some answers to how the trip went. In this video, we're going to discuss firstly, like the costs and how we put all the trip together. We're then going to move into our highlights, then the lowlights, and then it's a bit of general advice and some of our favourite memories from the trip.
There's a lot of things to discuss. We're going to try and keep it nice, short and sweet for you all so you can really be informed by what we did, how we saw it, what we experienced, and of course answer some of those key questions that you guys have got from this amazing USA Strata trip and Canada too. Let's not forget Canada.
Can't forget Canada. And of course, if you haven't already, check out the playlist because this is the final video going into this playlist. And we'll be ending this video with a bit of a montage, some of the highlights that I've put together from the trip. So stay watching for that at the end. But yes, firstly, I know a lot of comments came in about costs and how much has it cost us to do this huge trip. So I'm going to go straight out there and give you a number now. I'm not going to sort of put it into categories yet. I'll move on to that in a moment. But the price for me of this trip, and it'll be very similar for both of us.
Very similar.
But this was adding up all my spending money on food and drinks. Obviously, we bought a lot of stuff. I didn't buy 50 pints of milk. But, Alex didn't buy...
It could have done.
Alex didn't buy, like, a full van worth of Coke. So, you know.
It's
one of them. So, yeah, like, I've spent just over £3,800 on that trip. Like, that's everything together, straight out there with a number. So in terms of splitting it all down into categories, from what I remember, the flights were one of the cheaper things there. I think we paid like about £400 for the flights.
We did, it was very, very cheap. And the thing is, a lot of when you buy a lot of flights online, if you are using, you know, private companies just to look at your flight options, like Skyscanner, for instance.
Love Skyscanner.
You can fly out of one destination and back in from another, and you can find some really good deals, compare price and stuff. So, you know, you can save a lot of money if you just know what times you want to travel. And we had direct flights too. We didn't need connections or anything. Sometimes they can work out cheaper, but we actually saved quite a lot of money. Got some really cheap flights there for sure.
Yeah, I mean, we've got some great deals in the past. Probably the best flight deal we've ever had was our Asia trip, where we got loads. But yeah, in terms of that, it was around £400, and obviously it does fluctuate depending on the time of year. Hotels, now you saw in the travel vlogs, like, we stayed in some very interesting hotels.
And some of the hotels weren't hotels we planned from the very start of the trip, where we actually didn't get even to check into our first hotel. Things had to change, so there was a lot of fluctuation on different things there, for sure.
But yeah, in terms of hotels in general, it didn't cost us as much as what we expected. I know a lot of comments came in saying, why didn't you just go for an RV? When we first planned this trip, we were looking at an RV.
That was one of the options.
It was one of the things we were more leaning towards. Yeah. And then we started pricing things up and we thought, no, it is going to work out a lot cheaper actually going for what we did. In terms of hotels, again, pretty sure we paid, I think it was around £800
it
each.
It was very, very good.
Once we'd split very, very it good. For the hotels. Not too bad at all, really. Obviously, we did stay in some absolute dumps, didn't we, on some nights.
And we've got to consider as well that Brett, who you saw from the video, did join us for a few of those nights in hotels. Obviously, that helped split the cost a little bit. But generally speaking, you know, I think around £800 each for some some hotels across 22 days of a trip is actually a really, really good price to pay, to be honest.
Yeah, from when I was looking, just I think it was like £760 or something each. But to be honest, like, yes, that was like 3.5 weeks worth of accommodation. Some hotels were great and better than others.
Yeah, I
whereas I would say there was more good hotels than bad.
I think so, definitely.
It just took a long time for us to check in at some of them, which is...
at 2 o'clock in the morning is quite tiring, let me tell you.
I've seen a few other comments saying, you know, it's 2 o'clock in the morning you're rocking up at some of these hotels. Well, surely you're expecting for it to be long. To be honest, like, I think, you know, if you're paying for a service, you know, someone should be there, really. When it says 24-hour reception, you should be able to rock up at that time in the middle of the night and just pay and go in. But there you go.
And on a few occasions, too, they thought we were checking in early for the next day. So we get there at 4 a.m. some mornings and they think, Check-in is until 3 p.m. this afternoon, sir. I'm so sorry, I just want to go to bed.
I just really want to sleep. Like, you saw how tired we were.
It took its time.
Already, you can tell we're back to our normal selves sitting here.
And we'll discuss sleep a little bit more later, because I think there's a key point to that that was really worth discussing. But, I mean, hotels are so significant. If you are doing this kind of road trip, if you are looking at doing even something very similar, if not the same, you know, an RV may be your best option for this kind of trip, because you may just want a bed conveniently waiting for you whenever you need it. However, then you've got to consider your facilities, your showering facilities, and what you have available, and you're constantly relying on the things you live on the road. If anything, you see too much of the same four walls, especially when you're doing a lot of these 8-hour drives that we did across the trip. You've got to really take that into consideration.
It was nice to come out of the vehicle, park it up, and be on the bed, relax.
Air conditioning, our own environment, not breathing the same air. Little things to consider
and
in a big trip.
Moldy walls as one of the
Niagara Falls. Yeah, we're talking to you, hotel in Niagara Falls.
But just to summarise, in general, hotels, you know, they were okay. You know, for what we paid, I was quite happy, to be honest. In general, I don't think they were too bad at all.
Generally, motel rates seem to work out about the same as what you pay for a typical bed and breakfast in the UK at a seaside resort. So, actually, can't really argue with those prices, what you'd expect and what you'd anticipate, I'd say.
Yeah, definitely. Other costs then involved, of course, we've already got the flights out there, you've got your hotel sorted, it was getting around, it was that car hire, and like I said, just, you know, we looked into, like, the RV option, it worked out better for us hiring a car and having the hotels, but the hire car was one that would have been a lot cheaper if Alex was a little bit older, because we did have to pay the young driver's fee.
I may not look it, I'm only 22 years old at the time of recording.
there was a good, like, few hundred dollars on top, wasn't it?
Yeah, quite considerable. I think it was about nearly $400, which is a lot of money to increase an already rather expensive thing to do for a trip, because of the legal age for insuring a hire vehicle in the United States, which we completely respect. We wanted to do it properly, and to be honest with you, I don't think Sean could have done those drives on his own.
There's we needed two of us. We needed more, ideally, but we did it with the two of us. In terms of the cost for the car without that, I believe it was around £1,000.
About £1,000, exactly,
for the car hire for 3.5 weeks. You saw the car we had, it was a huge, like, SUV. And I think we've both got very different opinions on the car.
Yeah.
So,
I mean, I'm 6'6", okay? I'm sat down slouching now. If I sit up properly, I'm up here off the shot. But you've got to consider, I like leg room in a car. I like to be able to stretch, breathe a little bit. And I like to have good open road vehicles. You know, I want to really fill the lane on the road that I'm driving on. Sean, on the other hand, probably a completely different story.
The one thing that I really would do different is the car hire next time. For me, the car was way too big. Like, you know, I'd much rather have had a bit of a smaller vehicle. I'm not talking like something tiny, but, you know.
Maybe a Ford Focus size vehicle for those who are looking to compare to what we
talked about. Something a little bit smaller than what we had. And obviously, in terms of the fuel, it would have made it cheaper as well, which kind of leads me on to where I'm going to next, the fuel cost. But, you know, in general, yeah, I would have had a bit of a smaller vehicle. Nothing tiny, but I actually still felt like we were one of the biggest vehicles on the road away from trucks and stuff. And there was, you know, a lot of, like, normal style, like, 4x4 cars that on the roads. And I thought maybe we'd need something that size. I think we both thought we'd need it to kind of not feel like we're small on the road.
Not being a Fiat 500 driving like, hello.
Rob, the vehicle was easy enough to get used to. Driving over there was perfectly fine. No issues with driving over there. Make sure, you know, you do your research into stuff when it comes to, like, turning right on a red light and stuff. But no issues with that. But yeah, I would have gone for something a bit smaller. Fuel. Now, this is a big one. A lot of comments coming in. Like, in that vehicle, especially near the start of the vlogs, like, how much are you spending to fuel up that vehicle? I think Alex has got the total amount we spent.
I have in dollars. Now, I'm even using, I'm converting Canadian dollars to US dollars for the purpose of this explanation.
Fancy.
Now, Sean and I anticipated that we would spend approximately $500 on fuel across the trip. Now, we were really concerned at the start of the trip, thinking, oh no, we're putting $30 in every couple of hours of driving. This is going to really start racking up over time. And I actually think also, when you've got to consider you're driving an automatic vehicle, which a lot of cars in the US are, because it's a lot cheaper to do that with the fuel cost, which is a lot cheaper than what we pay in the United Kingdom for fuel, let me tell you that. We were driving a petrol vehicle. We anticipated about $500. I believe we were around about the $640 mark for fuel. So we weren't terribly over our budget for that, however we were. And one thing to really consider as well is, being US non-US citizens, rather UK visitors to the country, we have pay at the pump over here, right? You know, you can put your credit card in, debit card, you can pay, you put the fuel in, off you go, you don't need to go and speak to anybody. They have that facility in the US too. It's very, very common. However, they encourage you to enter your USA zip code, which is your postcode for the UK people watching, to pay for the fuel. Now that is great over here, but obviously without having the USA postcode registered to the card you're paying with, it's very, very difficult, which means
we have some issues.
You have to go and talk to the attendant. You go and put a prepaid amount in, so say you could go and put $40, pay $40 at the cashier, go and put that in at your car when you arrive and then drive straight off. However, what you've got to consider is, if you put $40 of fuel in and you only need $30, that's $10 of fuel wasted. You don't get the money back on that. You don't get a return or a refund. So there was a lot of preparation into making sure that we knew how much our car was consuming, and we were very confident on, you know, checking constantly how much we are putting into that vehicle. And also our mileage, our speed, the conditions we're driving in do take a big toll on that. But I think, you know, $640 for the size of the vehicle, you know, the amount of miles that we covered across this trip, pretty good going, I'd say.
How much would that cost you, like, in the UK?
In Europe, generally, it would cost a lot of money, obviously.
Our fuel is a lot higher price, so we did really well, actually. I agree. In terms of the miles that we covered, it was just over 5,500 miles we covered across the whole trip. That's not kilometres, that is miles. So, obviously, if you're in Europe and stuff, do your conversions there.
Miles. That's crazy.
Which is a lot. And I know we got very tired, but I'm not going to cover that now. This is just the cost. We'll come to that later. But in terms of the cost for that, not too bad. Slightly over. But really, you know, once you start splitting things, obviously Brett chipped in as well when he was with us. You know, we split it between us two at other points. So you're not too bad. You've got your flight over there. You've done your hotels. You've got your way of getting around. Park tickets, what did we do? Now, we did speak about this in the first vlog that we did from the Six Flags Park and the first one we did at a Cedar Fair Park. We'll just quickly recap on it. So we did have passes for both Cedar Fair and Six Flags that we bought. The Six Flags pass included parking and food, whereas the Cedar Fair pass just included parking and not food.
Yes, I agree.
I must say, both of them passes are really, really good value.
Fantastic.
We may not have had some of the best experiences at Six Flags Parks. No. However, for the price that we paid, brilliant. And they weren't too bad at all. About £150, I think, for Six Flags.
I think that's about right,
And Cedar Fair was a little bit more than that. Of course, you know, did you fluctuate,
Cedar Fair,
in different sales and stuff, sale prices. But
And when you consider that you are buying a pass to parks abroad, you don't know how much roughly you're going to be spending each day. But one thing that is really key to mention, you know, despite our experience at the Six Flags Parks, having dining options available on that pass too, getting a lunch meal, an evening meal, you know, getting your refillable cups for drinks throughout the day so you can constantly get refills from the machines, and also getting a snack option which could be a little dessert pot or...
We were fed well at Six Flags.
We were very, very well fed. However, the food is quite same. It's very typical fast food, theme park fast food rather than just generic fast food. You do find yourself eating a lot of the same things, especially if you're Sean and I, who tend to be quite fussy with our food.
Just
if
a little.
You didn't already know.
How many chicken tenders have you ate across the whole trip, Sean? Wow, that was another lot of comments. Yeah, do you want to know? I counted exactly how many. It was 512. No, I'm joking.
You were studying those meals, but the thing is, you've got to really consider, you know, you are in a theme park, and the Six Flags parks, the Cedar Fair parks, there's a lot of rides to get on. You know, you really want to save time in getting into the parks. And if we bought a ticket to each of those parks every day, we'd be in the entrance queue before the park opened. And when we're tired, some mornings we try to lay in to the latest point possible just to make sure we've got full energy for the day. Then you have to get in the ticket queue, buy a ticket, you know, show identification. It just takes time.
Nice and easy.
To have a pass, get in the park, get in, be ready for rope drop, which we caught pretty much most of the rope drops.
It was only one day where we missed the getting to the opening, but in general, you know, tickets were good. With the other parks away from Cedar Fair and Six Flags, we just bought standard tickets. Some of them we actually paid on the gate, which is a rare thing for us. A friend of ours who was actually in the vlog actually got us a cheaper admission to Hershey Park.
Thank you, Jeff. We love you.
Yeah, Jeff. Along with that as well, like Holiday Park. We just paid there. Knoebels and stuff. So, it's one of them, isn't it?
You can tell we did so much because you called it Holiday Park rather than Holiday World. Let him off. But I will say we also paid at Silver Dollar City on the admission price. Yeah. What's also useful to know is that some of these parks, we did find out, sometimes you can get very, very heavily discounted second days by paying at the gate, something you can't actually get online. So definitely do your research before buying park tickets, whether you buy them online or at the gate, because you might actually save yourself some money, get some coupons, discount vouchers to use.
Yeah.
Because we did see a lot of that along the trip.
We did. But in terms of that, they're your main bulk of costs, aren't they, for the trip? Then you've got like your bit of extras and stuff like parking. I must say, like, some of these parks out there do charge an absolute fortune for parking. Back here in the UK, like, people think, oh, £6 quite steep at Alton Towers, for example. Over there, the parking really varied. I think Hershey Park was probably the most expensive thing, wasn't that like $20-something?
Nearly $25, $26, I think,
it's a
for
lot
a day.
For parking.
To park at a theme park, you know, as much as it's nice to know that you can get your car close sometimes, those are the kind of costs you expect to pay for premium parking, where you are, you know, right at the entrance gate, where you don't have to walk far, you don't have to get transport to the entrance of the parks. Whereas somewhere around about the $10 mark, it felt a little bit more acceptable. Some parks, of course, were free of charge, which was really nice. And of course, if you've got season passes to a lot of the places, you tend to get discount, if not free parking anyway. You want to be there, you want to be close to the heart of the action, but some of the parking did seem very, very extortionate.
It did.
And it does lower the tone of the mood a little bit in the morning too. When
luckily though, at least we did have those passes that covered the parking.
I agree.
We're just in terms of other general costs, just buying small little bits, little bits of merchandise and stuff. I've not bought loads of merchandise, and that's why I'm not going to do like a separate video for the merch, because to be honest, I bought back 5 mugs, a few t-shirts, and that's about all. But I will, you know, show these bits at some point, maybe in a future merchandise video, along with other stuff what I've got. But it was just, I don't know if you can think of any other extra bits of spending. It's just little bits here and there.
And the thing
really
is, for us as well, you've got to think that you're not just eating in the parks, you're also eating out of the parks, you're also getting drinks. You know, we stopped at many shops like Target and CVS along the way to get refreshments to keep us going on the car journey. As soon as we arrived, Sean and I went straight to Target. We bought a 48 pack of bottled water just to keep us going in the car. You know, we've always got drinks ready to go. It's little things that you're doing just to make your life a little bit easier. But, you know, those initial costs certainly are so important, but whatever you spend after is kind of an extra, really, a bit of a treat. I think we've covered the main bulks of that, definitely, in the original costs.
Yeah, definitely. So that's a little look at all of the spending that we did on the road trip. Now, going on a huge trip like that means there's going to be lots of different highlights. And I'm sure me and Alex could sit here probably for like 24 hours doing a live stream or something, talking about all them highlights. So I know what you're all thinking. Oh, go on, do it. We've not got the time for that.
More energy right
moving
now.
Forward. you know, we've got a lot of stuff to move forward on the channel. But we are going to put a few of our highlights in the video for you now. We're going to do a little section next on lowlights. So I'll try not to touch on that too much. But I know some people in the comments said they thought it was quite critical on some of the stuff that we did on this trip. On this channel, on Theme Park Worldwide, we'll always be very, very honest with our opinions. And there were some rides that we did this trip that just didn't quite live up to some of the expectations created by people. You think, you know, sometimes people will say, oh, watch this, watch that POV. And you think, oh, you get yourself built up for it.
That's true.
And I might be guilty of that too. When I've gone to parks such as Port Aventura, I've built up Shambhala because for me personally, it's a pretty much perfect coaster. Steel Vengeance at Cedar Point. But when you go out there yourself, you don't want to look too much into what other people think, and you still got to not get yourself too excited, else it will become an overhype.
I agree. And also you've got to consider that a lot of these rides have been in our minds for years because of people we've known that have been out there to ride them. There's been some incredible coasters, and we won't take away the scale, the size, the sheer power and beauty of the design of these rides and attractions that we've seen. We've seen some of the most incredible looking riding coasters in the entire world on this trip. But you have to consider as well that sometimes having the mystery and surprise and the uncertainty of knowing what other people's thoughts are about a ride, or maybe even a mystery element that you're not quite aware of. Mystery Mine, for instance, we didn't know what to expect.
Yeah.
Those little things can really impact your visit to a park and what you experience on those rides and attractions. You know, we've come away and we feel so positive about this trip. We saw some incredible stuff. But you have to really consider that a lot of these rides and attractions, Kingda Ka, for example, is all I can think about right now. How many years that ride has ran around our heads. One day we're going to be riding it, from Sean seeing it in a book when he was a kid.
And it really didn't disappoint.
And it didn't disappoint. But some people have different opinions, you know, and they all have to kind of culminate and think, you know what, you have to appreciate them for what they are and what you experience on the day that you go to ride. Because we did only get one day at most of these parks.
Yeah, there was a lot of things that really stand out to me. I'd say there was certainly a lot more positive things that I did at these parks and with coasters.
Definitely.
Than negatives. You know, I know some people out there obviously think different, but these are our opinions. And for me, there's one ride that really stands high out above any of the others on the trip, and that's the Voyage.
Yeah.
Not a Holiday Park, a Holiday World.
Holiday World, thank you.
But yeah, anyway, that is a ride. Look back on the trip and think about going on that. I had really like high expectations for it, but it just like over-delivered. It was absolutely incredible. Always remember, we just sat on it and thinking, God, we're going to get there first. Normally we build up to rides, and you'll see it in the vlog. You know, I wanted to get straight in there. And again, I saw it in the comments, people saying, oh, we should have built up. I wanted to just get straight on it, and I'm glad we did with the weather we got that afternoon.
Yeah.
But for me, the Voyage, you know, it's straight in there, one of my favourite coasters of all time. An amazing ride, packed with airtime. But yeah, that's a big standout ride, and that park in general. Some of my other favourite coasters on the trip that, again, really stand out, Mystery Mine at Dollywood. Gerstar Eurofighter, all that theme in. But it's just a massive, you know, standout ride. Dollywood day one, the vlog from there, we were so tired. And the day two vlog, in my opinion, is definitely a much nicer watch in terms of the day, how it panned out, because I felt so much better, got to appreciate the park more. But yeah, for me, that was the big standout ride, along with the steam train. But yeah, that was another big memory for me, riding on that steam train.
Definitely.
Lightning Rod, my 1,000th coaster, a fantastic ride, not one of my personal favourites, but still a special moment from that trip. And I look at it and think, just after what I've just said with the voyage, that comes in as the next sort of the best memory, if you like, getting that special moment.
Yeah.
The ride might not have been as much as good as what I was hoping, but it was still a fantastic ride and a special ride for me. Yet if you've got a few more hearts to put in there.
I mean, first things first, I've got to say, there's a ride to me that will always stay in my head. The t-shirt I own, I still wear it to this day, and I will continue to wear it, is for Time Traveller at Silver Dollar City.
What a ride.
To get on that coaster, to see it being built, to see the construction teasers, to see the park really, really hyping that ride up, it did not disappoint. And to get a different experience every time you sat on that ride, to the point where at the end of the day, we were the last riders of the night, and we're the only guests on the train, with staff sat further back, we're all cheering and whooping as we go around. That memory will be in my head for the rest of my life, along with the rest of the things at Silver Dollar City. As much as we mentioned Dollywood there, on the same sort of theme and style there, Silver Dollar City, fire in the hole, got a shout,
yes,
got
a fire in the hole.
So many great rides at that park, beautiful park, and it was a theme park, a true beautiful themed park.
That was my favourite park of the trip.
I agree, hands
Silver
down.
Dollar City.
Favourite
that's
park.
What you wanted to hear.
That's
and that
it.
Is it.
Straight
yeah.
in there. I agree with you on
favourite
that.
Favourite park of the trip, Silver Dollar City. You know, obviously Cedar Point is a completely different class. I mean, you know, in terms of people said do some top 10 countdowns and stuff, you can't even put a park like Cedar Point and Silver Dollar City in the same category.
No, I agree.
Because they're very different. One's an amusement park, one's a full-on theme park.
Yeah.
But of course, I love Cedar Point a bit.
Yeah.
You know, it's a spectacular park, but I'd already been there last year. In terms of this trip for me, the standout was going to Silver Dollar City, and as Alex said, with Time Traveller and Outlaw Run.
I've got to bring up another park and say it whilst I'm here as well. Carowinds, I absolutely love that park. I remember nearly 10 o'clock at night, riding Fury 325 in the dark. People are cheering and whooping. The staff open the air gates for 5 seconds just to get guests in there, get them re-riding. And we even got one extra bonus ride whilst on the break when they're like, I know the park's closed, but do you guys want to go one more time? It was such a buzz, such an atmosphere. That park was fantastic. Some other great rides and attractions there too. Walking around this park that's separated by the two Carolinas. Really, really built in. The Cedar Fair Parks did certainly not under-deliver for me one bit. Had a great time. That continued.
Other than Kings Island.
Other than Kings Island. Other than Kings Island. However, up until the point of, you know, maybe earlier in the evening, things were great at Kings Island. We were having a fantastic time. We will not take away for 1 second the incredible rides and attractions of that park. Yes, there were some that didn't quite live up to that hype. I may be referring to Banshee there. I know some people love it. Some people hate it. It's a little bit like Marmite. We thought it was pretty average. We were kind of in the middle of the scale there. However, there were some incredible rides there to see. Of course, Mystic Timbers as well, to see that for the first time, hearing the hype about that ride for so long. Also, some other great wooden roller coasters there. And the memories that we created in that park throughout the day too. Actually being stood in King's Island, looking at the Eiffel Tower for the first time, as much as we went to King's Dominion and saw the second one, it was so impressive to finally see that structure in the flesh.
That leads on to my next highlight.
Go ahead.
It was King's Dominion. That day started where, I'm not going to lie, I wasn't that big of a fan of the park.
We're struggling.
I was really struggling at that point. I did Intimidator and it let me down in the start of the day. And again, going back to the comments, watch the full vlogs. That's what I advise. I'm not just saying this, you know, because I want you to watch time and stuff. Honestly, watch the full vlog, because I know a lot of people sort of jumped to conclusions there when they saw my, a bit like I jumped to conclusions with the ride, really, and I didn't enjoy it. If you watch that vlog right till the end, it's some of the best content from the whole trip. Like, we had an amazing evening with Taylor from Coaster Studios there. And of course, the day just kept on getting better. We did that night ride that was incredible, and all the Grand Carnival entertainment.
I agree.
We were dancing, singing along.
I've got to make the point and say, I only actually rode Intimidator 305 that morning when we had that kind of ride that wasn't quite up to the standards of what we expected. And if anything, I left King's Dominion at the end of the day thinking, oh man, I really should have gotten that night ride, because maybe, just maybe, my expectation of that coaster would have changed. Seeing the reactions, seeing the buzz, and even seeing some members of the general public who I'd seen this morning, that morning on the ride, who'd gone on it and had the same sort of mutual feeling as us to come off and be completely blown away by this ride. If anything, I was disappointed in myself for not giving it that extra bit of time. So I'm looking back at myself and thinking, wow, that's something I need to go back for. But that Grand Carnival celebration, you know, waving around these big, you know, these big necklaces and stuff, it was insanity. But do you know what? Some of the best memories of my entire life.
Parades, you know, incredible. Like, it was so good. You know, so many highlights. Honestly, we could sit here for a long time. This is just a few of them. And, you know, I know people say, oh, you missed this, you missed that.
Yeah, definitely.
Of course, at the end of every vlog, we do share our highlights anyway. This is just sitting here now. We've not got any paper, no scripts or anything, no laptop. We're just going off in our head what comes into our memories. Another big one for me is Hershey Park.
Yeah.
That was a part that really, like, over-delivered for me. Like, operations, staff friendliness. As much as a couple of the rides, again, may not have been what I was hoping for, the park was lovely.
Beautiful.
A lot better than the chocolate, which I do not enjoy.
And I've got to make a point and say that Great Bear is the greatest B&M inverted coaster I have ever done.
It's
going to take a lot to beat that ride for me. It was absolutely insane. The weather did not put a dampener on our day, certainly not on our mood, and I can tell you one thing for sure, I did cry at Cow Animatronics on a chocolate themed dark ride. You can tell that the energy was getting to me, the emotions were running through my body, the adrenaline certainly of getting all these world class attractions at a chocolate theme park where they had milk vending machines. Oh my word, milk vending machines. For someone like me who is addicted to drinking milk, just so you know, I just love it, I've drank it my whole life, you know, to be in that atmosphere, to be immersed into these worlds. And you know, even some of the parks that were amusement parks rather than theme parks, to get on quality coasters, great atmosphere. Yeah. Oh, there's so much we could literally
there
talk
is.
About it all
and another couple of memories coming to my head, something we've not really spoke about that much, is Steel Vengeance. I mean, it's your number one coaster after a start at the end of the day.
It did not get number one at first. It did not even deserve a top spot right there. It just didn't do it for me. I didn't sit into the restraint right. I'm a tall guy, as I mentioned earlier. Restraints aren't always built for people my size. I appreciate that. You know, to go to a night ride, really ready, really thinking strategy in the queue line. How am I going to sit in this ride? How am I going to make myself enjoy Steel Vengeance? And hopefully, touch wood, no pun intended, make it a number one coaster. And that is exactly what I did. Walked out with a number one coaster. And of course, number two with the Voyage as well at Holiday World.
Yes, not far.
Holiday World.
That's the ongoing joke now.
That's staying forever.
The best roller coaster ride I've ever had in my life was that night on Steel Vengeance.
Incredible.
The first night, amazing. The second night for me, it was absolutely outstanding. That thing was running so well. It is the best coaster.
It felt like there was smoke coming from under the wheels because there was just so much electricity of the energy of the people in that train. It was insane. And oh, there's so many moments. It'd be so hard to pick, but I've got to ask you, which way is Kennywood?
That way. That's another thing.
Kennywood. You know. Don't forget Kennywood. Seeing Steel Curtain Test during its testing phase. As soon as we walked in that part, the first ride we actually saw running around was Steel Curtain. What an experience that was too.
Knobles
too.
Flying turns were something that I followed so much.
Insane.
And to get to ride it, of course, I know some people said, oh, you know, Phoenix should be the ride. At the end of the day, these are my personal opinions. You know, Phoenix was absolutely incredible.
Beautiful.
One of the best wooden coasters I've been on. But in terms of that special memory, when you've watched a ride being built for so long, that took so long to build. Yeah. Like 6 years or something crazy, but honestly, they're just some of our highlights. Like, we've probably missed some big things there. What we're saying,
there's too many.
That just shows how much of an absolutely amazing time we had that trip. And I would
say,
you know, a good 80% of the trip was amazing, good times.
World class.
But on this channel, we'll always be honest, and
we
know that there's some things that we definitely do differently. We're going to move on forward now and talk about some of the things that we definitely changed and some of the more negative experiences from our road trip.
So moving on to the lowlights of the trip, obviously we just mentioned about how many incredible, fantastic things we saw. That 80-20 balance of the park is really there. Let's talk a little bit about that 20% that just wasn't quite up to what we expected. Nothing that necessarily we're going to regret ourselves in our lives because it added to the 80% of great things we saw. One thing I've got to start with, I've got to mention it. Sean's got a USA flag on his t-shirt. I've got a UK one. I just noticed. How amazing is that? We are so passionate about this trip. We saw some incredible things. One of the really biggest culture shocks for me was learning, even though, you know, we speak the same language in the US as we do in the UK, there are still things that are done very different in the culture between the two countries. Obviously, in the UK, we don't open our parks playing the national anthem. We do have one, of course, like every nation does. It was a new experience to us, hearing that anthem blasting out of the park. honestly, emotions are running so high because we think it's amazing how patriotic the country is, and it's really celebrated through the life of the guests that visit that park. And also, it was really interesting to me hearing how differently people review and give opinions on rides. I've noticed there's a lot of short answers to rides, whether it's good or bad. It's never really explained in detail. And obviously, a lot of the amusement parks there don't capitalize on theming like a lot of parks do in Europe. And I think for the, you know, there are a few occasions on this trip where we had to really forget about the Europe parks, forget about the theme parks, and just really put our amusement park head on, which is so hard, as you imagine, living in the UK, being UK residents, only having just a handful of amusement parks in comparison to theme parks. It's really hard to make that switch when you are theme park enthusiasts. We are coaster fans. Sean's done over 1,000. I've done over 400. It's nothing quite as what he's done. However, we are theme park enthusiasts.
We are.
Statistics don't stick in our heads. You'll see, we get things wrong. Holiday park.
And I saw, a few people in the comments said, you know, Sean, you've contradicted yourself throughout this series, and you've said, you are a theme park enthusiast. Why have you just gone and just done loads of coaster after coaster after coaster? That's because a lot of the parks that we went to were very coaster heavy. And you've got to think, you know, if you're American watching this and you're coming over to Alton Towers, there's 10 roller coasters up there at Alton Towers. You know, if you've got one day at that park, you know, are you going to go and do something like Jewel, for example, if you don't have the time, which is a haunted house, an interactive ride, for those of you that don't know. You've got to think, you know, you are going to prioritise doing the likes of Nemesis, of Wicker Man, getting on them big rides.
The rides that have been breathed to you as an enthusiast through the years. Generation coasters that have been passed down, especially like we mentioned Nemesis. You travel for the things you hear about and you know you've got to do. You know you're not going to leave this country, or the same for us in the US, and think, damn, I really wish we did those rides. However, there were occasions where the parks just did not give us that opportunity to either get on the ride we wanted or give us the correct information for how and when we can get on these rides and why. And obviously, again, building on with the hype of that too, it's so important to make sure that information is heavily communicated both between the park to the guests and the guests amongst each other, because there's a lot of information we got, especially talking about Kings Island right here, you know, where the park did close an hour before. The park was scheduled to close at 10 p.m. Close at 9 p.m. However, what's key to note here as well, and I don't know how well we touched on this too much in the vlog, but this did happen, the rides closed at 7 p.m. Because of the weather was bad. We can't deny that. We were prepared for that. We knew what to expect. We bought clothes in just in case things did not work out to plan. However, we decided to go and sit in Starbucks, wait for that storm to pass off. However, we were told at 9 p.m. when the major announcement that the park was closed an hour before, which didn't bother us too much. We were a little bit gutted, but, you know, these things do happen. We've known it here at Blackpool Pleasure Beach, for instance.
It does happen. I don't agree with it, any part.
No. Nobody wants it. When you pay for a ticket, you want to be there for that amount of time advertised. Things didn't work out. However, what we did find out is, even though the storm did kind of have points where it passed up and it eased to a point where rides could have reopened, the rides closed at 7 p.m. and were staying closed from 7 p.m. Those rides weren't planning on reopening. Staff were being sent home.
I mean, we talked about all this in the vlog, so check it out.
It's little things that you really want to know when you've travelled so far. We speak the same language. We want the same things. Staff want guests to be happy because it's their lives that are easier and their work lives. We're guests who've travelled over 4,500 miles just to get on some of these signature rides, to do a last ride of the night on the Beast, for example. You know, we were gutted. We were so emotionally distraught.
It was the miscommunication.
It is. It really got us down, definitely. But these things are to be expected. However, you know, again, it's still 20%. 80% what we saw was still wonderful. You know, there were a few negatives, but, you know, we can kind of move on from those in our lives.
A big thing what a lot of people noticed throughout the trip was our health. And I know there was a lot of concerns for both of us. Towards the end of the trip, obviously, you know, Alex did have a lot of rest time. But throughout the trip, we were both feeling it at various points. Like, going back way to the start of it all, you know, I sounded awful with a chest infection. Alex had issues with his toe. You know, we didn't start off great, but then we did get better. And throughout the whole trip, our health and tiredness sort of fluctuated. It kept a bit of a wave.
It was a roller coaster.
I actually felt, towards the end of the trip, better than I did near the start. Yeah. But in terms of the tiredness levels on this trip, we took too much on. If you are doing something like this in the past, in the future, sorry, you need to really think about the days you are putting into it. And obviously, we built this itinerary that, you know, we thought at the time we were going to be able to do, and we did. However, there were some days when we both really struggled.
There were consequences to doing the amount of things we did in the scale of time that we had. You know, we've traveled a long way. Sean mentioned I had a broken toe, Sean had a chest infection. Towards the end of the trip, I was really tired. towards the very start of the trip, I've got to go back to this point. Sean was very, very poorly on the journey to America too. It was something that we talked about prior to traveling, his health. We'd both been checked out. We knew we were going to be okay, but still we weren't feeling ourselves from the offset. Sean was at a point where actually we were concerned about how far we're going to progress with our emotional feelings, our energy levels, and certainly Sean's health. Flash forward to the end of the trip, the last few days, I was having the same conversation with Sean about not being able to get to where I need to be in the health level that I wanted to feel. It's so tiring. Yeah. When you are driving for long hours, you are on theme parks for 10, 11, 12, Hershey Park, 13-hour days.
And then a big drive.
And then a big drive.
Cedar Point, we drove all the way down to Tennessee. The layout, which we did the order of the parks in, was done for a reason.
Yeah,
it was done around drive times when we were best driving, opening hours and stuff. But the best thing, really, that we can take from this whole trip is to really think about rest days. And we've both said, doing something like this again, you want at least one day out of seven where you don't really schedule in any driving, schedule in any parks. And then best case scenario, if you are feeling fine, you can always go and find something else to do, theme park wise. Because there's a lot of smaller parks that we could have gone and got the odd couple of coasters and rides at if we'd have wanted to. But I'm so proud that we managed to complete the trip. And I know Alex didn't come to Coney Island. I was gutted. You can probably tell in that last vlog. I was upset that Alex couldn't make it, because it's a shame that, health.
I was beyond exhausted. I did go to New York and did a little bit of sightseeing just to get a bit of fresh air, but I was completely exhausted. It gets to a point where you feel that, where does my health have to take priority? That was the point for me. Had that trip gone on any longer without the rest days, I would have not been able to do a thing. I wouldn't even be able to step on a roller coaster. You know, you look at our opinions, you look at things that you maybe thought, Sean and Alex should have loved that ride. How could they have not loved it? No matter where it was in the trip, whether it was right at the end when we were really exhausted, right at the beginning where we were ill and we were feeling it in our ill health, or in the middle of the trip where we're thinking, right, okay, we've burnt our first load of energy here, we need to start bottling up and storing it. There were so many intervals where things got to us emotionally, physically, health-wise, whatever it is. You know, you've got to consider, if you flew all the way to one of those parks, say you just went to Caravans, I'm just picking a random example here, because you really wanted to get on Fury 325, and that was the only park you were visiting, or maybe you're just doing two or three, maybe you are going to have much higher opinions of all these rides and attractions, because your mind is focused that you're here at one park, two or three. We had 20 different theme parks, over 200 roller coasters and different rides and attractions to get on. We've got to some parks, we completely forgot the name of some of the B&M inverts because there's so many we saw.
Most of them are Batman the Ride, though.
Most of them are Batman the Ride. Which way is Kennywood, by the way?
That way.
Okay, just checking.
But yeah,
we did it. We're here,
we completed
we're back,
it.
We're talking about it, we're still smiling, we've still got these smiles on our faces. Yes, we had the doubts. Yes, we have the health, the concerns. Yes, maybe you didn't see the Sean and Alex that you know. However, it was still the honest Sean and Alex.
I think these videos are some of the most natural things you'll ever watch.
The most telling videos you'll ever see.
And even here, we're not sitting here now saying, I hope you've all enjoyed the biggest trip ever on the bottle wide. Everything was amazing, because it wasn't.
It wasn't.
This is the thing with this channel. You're watching this now, you're always going to get honesty. You have since it started back in 2012, and you're going to as long as it lasts. We'll always be honest on this channel. We're just following on a little bit from what Alex said about opinions. Some people, I think we're quite surprised at some of our opinions on rides. But like Alex said, tiredness maybe played a little part of it, but there was certainly some rides in particular, and I'll say it out here, Lightning Rod, I felt fine on that second day at Dollywood, one of the best days of the trip, and I rode Lightning Rod and it felt exactly the same as it did when I was tired. So I think personally, would my opinion change if I was feeling a little bit better?
Probably not
on most rides, maybe a couple of days, but genuinely there was a few rides that were a disappointment, and everyone, like I said earlier in the video, has got them different opinions. But I think we've covered that, a lot of the negatives. We were tired.
Definitely.
At points.
You see maybe around an hour of a 13 hour day at the theme park, you have to consider that every morning we woke up and we had the same fresh mentality. We always tried to reset our minds, whether we had a good day, outstanding day, or not so good day in the park. We always went with a fresh new attitude and approach. Although it may not have shown in the way we introduced ourselves at the start, because there was still tired, there was still fatigue, there was still illness in certain parts, we always tried to give you a fresh take, because we wanted to treat each park, even though it was a chapter of different parks across the trip, as a new day. And that's something we always did. So if you felt that things seem to become similar with our opinions, maybe it's because, not because of the tiredness or fatigue or the motivation, maybe those rides didn't give us exactly what we needed.
We share quite a lot of similar opinions anyway. I know some people said in the comments again, refs in the comments a lot, but I do look, I read every comment. Like, you now comment on this video, I know, like, I watch
it's
it.
Been
yeah.
seen.
I see everything and I'll heart
you.
You
may get a reply,
Yeah, I look at everything. And I know there's people out there saying, Alex, your opinion, all you're saying is what Sean said. At the end of the day, you know, we do have a lot of similar opinions. Like, we both got the same sort of background.
However,
with
there are some opinions
stuff, you know.
That are very, very, very opposing.
It was a lot. Like,
there's some rides that Sean and I on this trip looked at each other and I said to Sean, how did you enjoy that? Or he'd say to me, how did you not enjoy that? Or, you know, there'd be so many differences. I look back at trips we've done in the past. Fantasialand, for instance. Sean, you love that park. It means the world to you. To me, not interested. Don't care if I don't return anytime soon. We do have these opponents and opinions, but however, you spend so much time, you have the same energy, the same hype, the same conversations, the same friendship. There are going to be similarities. However, I can promise you, if you really look back through those videos, there were quite a few differences. If you didn't see me re-ride a coaster, there's probably a reason for it. I may not have touched on it. However, if you saw Sean and Brett on the front row of a coaster and not me there, there is a reason for that. There are differences of opinions. They're going to happen. We're honest. We've been honest. We will continue to be because we want you guys to see the real us. And I think you've really got a reflection of that on this trip.
Definitely.
Good or bad.
Definitely so. But there we go. We sort of made it towards the final part of the video that we're going to cover. We've gone through all the different costs. We've gone through the highlights. We've gone through the lowlights. We're now just sort of going to talk a little bit about, like, you know, wrap this all together and say, like, some of our, you know, like, one thing really that stands out from us in terms of, like, off-camera stuff as well. So we'll move forward and, wrap up this video and talk a little bit about that. So you've seen lots of content on the channel, hours and hours worth of content from this trip. And just before we move into this little video presentation that I've put together, a little montage, a few bits that really stand out. I mean, some funny bits, not necessarily from the rides either. No. Now, this is, you know, some of the stuff that has been mentioned on camera and other bits that haven't. But for me, something that really stands out from the travel vlogs. And we were driving along in the middle of the night. So, yeah, I was driving
still
along.
Heart still going.
And then literally I heard like the, like, if you've watched The Purge,
you know exactly what that was.
And it's like they were testing, like, the security systems on the radio. You know, we don't have that over here, like, not as far as I know anyway. I've not been,
it's like a terror alert alarm.
Yeah.
That's what they described.
I really, like, wondered what was happening. I thought that something was actually happening at that point. I was about to maybe actually pull over. I thought it's playing because an incident has actually happened.
And we also questioned, Sean thought it was on me on my phone trying to wind him up by playing a random sound whilst asleep. Like, I had my phone.
It freaked me out. I was so tired as well.
And I thought he was like, he'd staged some kind of purge recreation from the parks. I was like, I really didn't know what to anticipate. It was terrifying.
Well, that's a big one for me. Have you got to?
I mean, for me, I've got to go in there and throw some dirty laundry at you. No pun intended. Sean and I actually saw a full-size washing machine. Looked perfectly good, looked perfectly working order, just sat in the middle of the road. We were driving along 70 miles an hour, which was the speed limit. We were driving along the highway, two lanes at this time. Was I driving or were you driving?
I think you were driving.
I was driving. And Sean said, what's that up there? And we got quite a bit of distance. Still, then we're traveling fast. And I said, it's like a washing machine.
And it was like
a massive, massive washing machine. Just sat there, upright, sat how it should be, like you're about to chuck your dirty laundry in. And I just was like, slow down. I had to undertake it.
Luckily, it was daytime.
Yeah, it was
most
sat in the fast lane.
Of the journeys we did on that trip were at night. And if we'd have seen that at night, we could have hit that.
And let's just say, you know, there's a lot of debris. We made a character up called Deb Ree because we saw a lot of debris. On the side, there's a lot of flat tyres.
A lot.
And also cones. Let's just make sure that we mention cones. Like the traffic cones here that we have like this. Oh, no. They're like bins. And like wheelie bins are huge.
Right.
If you hit one of them, they're going flying. Let me just see. They are scattered everywhere. There's some really narrow lanes too to drive down. Really quite scary.
Away from like the drive and stuff, we went to some incredible places away from the parks as well. We went to the Gateway Arch. That was absolutely incredible in St. Louis. And we went up to the top of that and it was incredible, wasn't it?
Yeah,
like seeing that drive along.
Incredible.
You can see it from like 6 miles back.
That's insane.
Coming down to it. We went to see that. Of course, when we went into Canada, we went to see Niagara Falls, one of the best things I've ever seen. I'd say that's probably my second favourite thing I've ever seen in my life, the first one being the Grand Canyon. Canyon, but what an amazing like natural wonder to see. I mean, we're used to all this fake stuff, aren't we, in theme parks, you know, and we love Disney, but it's all, you know, all your fake castles and stuff, whereas that, it's a natural waterfall, and seeing stuff like that, amazing. I actually think it makes it more impressive when we go to as many parks like we do and see all this fake stuff, so then actually go and see the real deal, the real amazing stuff.
Just to believe it's actually there, obviously, for me, towards the end of the trip, seeing WWE Studios, gotta mention the fact that I saw that, massive wrestling fan, diehard fan, that was a dream come true for me. I'd seen that building on TV since I was a child. Nice to see that and believe it. Gotta mention one funny thing though. Sean and I probably forgot about this actually towards the end of the trip. Sean and I pulled into a gas station around 2 o'clock in the morning.
Yes.
And we were queuing up for a Subway. It was very quiet services. There wasn't really much happening. There was no one really in
not
there.
Not the New York Subway. No, not the New York Subway.
An actual Subway.
Eat fresh.
Yeah. And we were ordering after. It was really quiet. The music was turned down really low. This kind of atmosphere thing. And then next thing we heard a bong, our kind of talking level like this. Truck driver 273, your shower cubicle facility is now ready. Please head to shower cubicle number 5. And Sean and I were like, what is happening? Now, if you imagine you're going into Argos and you know it comes up with order number, order number 629 to checkpoint A. They have like a system for it if truck drivers need a shower. And honestly, I was on the floor laughing, and I nearly lost my voice at this point. Sean had completely lost his, and we are streaming with tears. This Subway lady probably thought, what the hell are these two British guys
doing? Just reminding us of something else from
go
the
on,
comments.
Go.
Just need to reference, talking go about on. Washing and showers.
Oh, yes.
Someone commented and said, what did you do about your laundry? We took enough pants and socks for
the laundry.
Oh, we
were covered.
We didn't have to do like any, you know, go to the laundrette.
And I actually went to the laundrette at Cedar Point too, in the hotel. I actually went and did everybody's washing for them, for me, Sean and Brett. And we did wash them on our t-shirt throughout as well, made sure they were all clean and fresh. Shoes, making sure they were aired perfectly. We were feeling pretty good hygiene-wise.
Yeah, we didn't have to like go off-site anywhere and do anything. Like, you know, it was all just...
We didn't have a personal cleaner to help us either. It was just, you know, do things when we can, make sure we're fully stocked up, fully prepared. And, you know, I think everything...
You know, there was generally no turning pants inside out like we did on the Asia trip. You know, none of that.
Did you do that?
I forget. in terms of the trip in general, I would say it's been a big success. Like, it's been wonderful.
We've done it.
But, of course, we're sitting here now, you know, 5 weeks after coming back, and you're watching this video a few days after that last travel vlog went online. And, what an absolutely amazing trip. One of my favourite trips that I've ever done. I would say we saw so much, it was a big success, but we've certainly learned our lesson. The big thing for me is tiredness. We've learned that, you know, our bodies aren't machines.
No.
As much as we love these roller coasters, you know, you have got to think of your health. You know,
speak for yourself. You know, belt machine, no, I'm not.
We've really got to think of your health. And if you are doing something like this, please. Think about your
consider
health,
it.
Learn from us. Like, you know, you're spending £3,800 upwards on something, you need to make sure that your health's right.
And you might be, and if you're looking at us two thinking, their health, I'll be fine, please do consider it, because there are things that no physical athlete or anybody can compare for. Theme parks is great. You might have the stamina to walk around in the sunshine all day, ride roller coasters, get the adrenaline rush, eat and drink in unhealthy foods. But then you've got to think about the sleep, the long drives, staying awake, planning and mentally preparing for the things
and then
you have coming
actually
ahead.
Filming this content for you guys.
We've looked at this camera in 20 different states and in Canada recently, and I can't believe we're looking at it now back home in reality. We saw so much, tried to capture as much as we can. You know, the vlogs are a small part of this
trip, really. Like, yes, there's been a lot, but it's still a small part of it. But, you know, just in general, it's been absolutely an adventure. It's been wonderful, it really has. The next time you see a trip of that scale here on this channel, who knows when it'll be. You know, who knows what we've got planned.
Where we're gonna
that
be.
Was a big thing that we wanted to do, but there's one thing for sure guaranteed. The next thing you will see out of a big trip on this channel, much like this one, it will be 100% honest, and also there'll be some rest days added into the itinerary.
Maybe that's a good plan. I think that's a good idea.
Definitely.
Hopefully somewhere with a beach would be really nice. Thank you so much, because honestly,
as much
of these vlogs are a small part of the trip that we did, one of the biggest parts to this trip, might not sound like it, is you guys who are watching this video and have watched any of the videos, liked any of the social media posts, followed me on Instagram at AlexTheCrumpOfficial, or just supported us by seeing us at a theme park, wishing us well, or since coming back, asking us how it's been. You know, it's been so hard to put this trip into words, because to be honest, I don't think it's fair to put this trip into words. We've tried to summarise it a little bit, but there is so much we saw, and without you guys, you know, cheering us on and supporting us, wherever you've watched us in the world, be it the US, be it here, or in Europe or around the world, thank you. We love you.
We met so many fans of the channel on the way as well. All the social media comments that were coming in as we did the trip, giving us that support. So again, from the bottom of my heart, thank you so much for watching all those videos and everything else here on Theme Park Worldwide. And of course, just want to say a big thank you to the milkman himself, Alex, for the trip. I mentioned it in a couple of the videos, but Alex was the one that put a lot of the itinerary together back at the start. And yeah, without
this,
Alex,
this sort of thing usually starts on Christmas Day for Sean and I. The Asia trip was booked and planned on Christmas Day. I sat down with Sean. Sean's like, "Let's go to Tokyo. Let's go and see Disney." I was like, "Hold up. We can hold my milk. We can do more than this." And we booked it. Florida, that you saw us go to in 2018, we've booked Christmas 2017. And this trip, all around Christmas time, Sean and I were thinking, what can we see in the US? How about you go see 5 or 6 parks? Hold a lot of my milk, Sean. Let's go see 20. We've done it.
We did it, and it was definitely
a
success.
Here's to the next one.
That is it. The end of us talking about our huge USA road trip. It's done. Go back to the start of this playlist. And honestly, I'm not just saying this, but you really want to watch it in order and go through it all individually. It might take you months and months to plan time into your busy lives to watch it all, but I really do recommend it because you get to follow the full journey, the full experience. And we're going to end this video.
I'm emotional, stop thinking.
That is it for the Theme Park Worldwide USA Strata Trip. It started as an American dream. The dream has happened, it's become a reality. I'm going to end it over the next few minutes with this montage that I've put together. Thank you to Alex. Thank you to all of you for watching. I just want to say a big thank you to Charlotte for supporting me with the trip as well and doing a lot of the admin work whilst I was away, replying to comments, tweets, Instagram, messages. Charlotte did a lot to take the strain off me whilst I was away. So, and she does all the time. So thank you so much, Charlotte. But most importantly, thank you to all of you guys for watching. We really appreciate it. That is all on this trip, but I'm sure it's not going to be the last you're going to hear of it. These are memories that are going to last a lifetime, and that's what you're going to see now in this montage. Thank you very much for watching, and here we go. Here's a little look, a bit of a roundup from the Theme Park Worldwide Summer 2019 USA Strata Trip. And the start of the biggest ever trip in Theme Park Worldwide history. Here she is! Here's our baby!
How are
we? Time traveler here at Silverdale City was really good fun. Oh my god, so we've just come off the voyage. Such a bucket list coaster for me. We had that front row ride, it was incredible. Here we go! Yeah! Oh wow! Oh, hey. Whoa. The operations there were absolutely incredible. That is an absolutely world-class night ride.
For me, it is the best invert I have ever done.
Amazing to see the Gateway Arch. So there we have it, 1,000 roller coasters.
But it was number one! Yeah.
Oh my God. Today I had the best ride I've ever had on a roller coaster since I started riding them. And welcome to the visitor center here at Niagara Falls. Oh, here we go.
It's even got a built-in blow-up pillow.
It is the best $16.83 I've ever spent in my entire life.
Oh, hey. Oh, it's long. Theme Park Worldwide on YouTube. And did it disappoint? No, it certainly didn't. That was absolutely brilliant. World class.
It's been a bucket list of mine for many, many years to ride on the iconic Coney Island Cyclone. Thank you so much yet again for joining us on this epic adventure. We've done this big trip, but who knows what's coming in the future, because there's still a few places out there that we've not explored. We'll be right back.